Mic check for the court reporter. Sound check for the court reporter.
The Subcommittee on Information Technology will come to order. Without objection, the chair is authorized to declare a recess at any time. Today's hearing has a narrow but very important focus on the Federal Law Enforcement Agency's use of cell site simulator devices, also known as MZ catchers or stingrays. But today's hearing also touches on fundamental questions of privacy that we have grappled with since the founding of this country. When and how can or should the government use technology to locate people? What notice or information, if any, must people be given about the technology used to locate them? To what extent must the government take into account the rights of innocent people who may be sucked into a law enforcement dragnet? And how can we protect our civil liberties and defend the homeland at the same time? These are essential questions. Today's hearing won't give us a definitive answer to all these questions, but I hope that representatives from DHS and DOJ will be able to shed light on some of them and that this conversation will begin to reveal answers on others. Tracking a person's movements for an extended period of time can reveal almost anything and everything about them, what establishments they frequent, whether or not they are churchgoers, who their friends are, and their day-to-day hobbies. Geolocation is more than a record of where you are or were, it's a window into who we are. The founders considered the ability of average citizens to keep things private from the government of such importance that they built it into the Constitution. Thanks to the Fourth Amendment, we have the right to be secure in our persons, houses, papers, and effects against unreasonable searches and seizures. Simply put, unless and until law enforcement can convince a judge to issue a probable cause warrant, they don't get to disrupt that security. Cell site stimulator devices work by impersonating a cell phone tower and forcing all mobile phones within range into connecting with the device. Once a stingray connects with a cellular phone, it is able to identify that cell phone's unique identifying number and then identify the approximate location of the phone. There are also collateral consequences for the owners of non-targeted phones in the area. While searching for the target phone, the device will also make contact with other non-target cell phones that happen to be within range of the simulator device, even if those phones' owners are not suspected of criminal wrongdoing. After considerable congressional, public, and media interest, both DOJ and DHS decided to create agency-wide policies governing the use of these devices. While there may be some lingering concerns about the substance of the policies, which we will discuss here today, imbalance of policies are a big step forward for DOJ and DHS and a win for transparency and privacy advocates everywhere, as well as this is a win for the American people. What does worry me, however, is that it took the extra scrutiny to convince DOJ and DHS to make these changes, and I remain troubled that federal law enforcement is still not embracing transparency the way they need to in 2015. I know, and I think better than most, the need for the government to keep certain things secret from the public. Secrets in the wrong hands get people killed, but secrecy is a double-edged sword. Right now, only about 1 in 4 Americans trust the federal government. If you do not have the trust of the people you are fighting for and with, you have nothing. I commend DOJ and DHS for their efforts here. But this can't be the exception. Law enforcement must continually strive to appropriately balance privacy and security issues in the digital age, and they must continue to be transparent with Congress and the public about the choices and trade-offs we face. I hope today's hearing is a small step in beginning to bridge the gulf that has developed between our nation's policies and the citizens they're meant to protect. Our witnesses today are Elena Tyrangill, the Principal Deputy Assistant Attorney General for Office of Legal Policy at the U.S. Department of Justice, and Seth Stoddard, the Assistant Secretary of Threat Prevention and Security Policy at the U.S. Department of Homeland Security. I thank the witnesses for being here today and look forward to their testimony. And now it's a pleasure to recognize the gentleman from California, Mr. Liu, for 5 minutes for your opening statement.
Thank you, Chairman Hurd, for holding today's hearing to examine law enforcement's use of cell phone tracking devices. In September of this year, the Department of Justice announced its new policy on cell site simulators, commonly known as stingrays, aimed at enhancing privacy protections and establishing a consistent legal standard for obtaining authority to use a simulator. Most federal law enforcement will now be required to obtain a search warrant supported by probable cause consistent with the protections of the Fourth Amendment. Earlier this week, the Department of Homeland Security announced its department-wide policy, which similarly establishes a higher and more consistent legal standard requirement. At the time of the DOJ announcement, I released a statement calling the policy change a welcome first step and suggested we need committee hearings on this issue, and I'm pleased Chairman Hurd is holding this hearing today. As new technology empowered law enforcement with unique capabilities, stringent rules are needed to safeguard against abuse of our civil liberties. The search warrant requirement establishes a consistent legal standard for federal authorities and will allow increased oversight of the use of cell site simulators. Even those limited circumstances when a warrant is not required for use of such a cell site simulator, there are controls in place to help ensure that the exceptions are not abused. I look forward to the witnesses today providing more details on what those exceptions are and the safeguards that are put in place. These federal policies are needed to guard against abuse of individuals' privacy and civil liberties. Their data collection retention practices and new policy are intended to enhance privacy protections, and hopefully they do so without undermining a law enforcement tool. I believe that these policy changes by DOJ and DHS, while a good step forward, could and should go further. As the ACLU has noted, the policy guidance contains significant gaps, including overbroad exceptions to warrant requirement, lack of notice to individuals impacted by stingrays, and lack of transparency reporting. These agency policy changes also do not meaningfully restrict state and local officials who use stingrays in the majority of U.S. states that do not regulate them. I hope that state and local law enforcement agencies follow the lead of these federal policies and implement stringent privacy protections and legal standards. In my home state of California, for example, Governor Jerry Brown recently signed into law the California Electronic Communications Privacy Act, joining 9 other states with laws that require state law enforcement to get a warrant before using cell site simulators. The California law also requires a warrant before law enforcement can search metadata or other electronic communications. I also note that the federal policy changes discussed today here are reversible, and they do not apply to all federal agencies. As we have seen in the past, not all administrations or agencies have had respect for the Fourth Amendment or our civil liberties. We should follow the lead of multiple states, including my own, and enshrine these policies into law across all agencies to make clear that the Fourth Amendment needs to be respected and persons have the right to be free from unreasonable search and seizure by the government. I'd like to commend Chairman Chaffetz, Ranking Member Cummings, Subcommittee Chair Hurd, and Ranking Member Kelly for the oversight work related to cell site simulators. In April of this year, the committee sent letters to DOJ and DHS requesting information policies surrounding cell site simulators, which increase the committee's visibility into the policies governing the use of this law enforcement tool. I also like to thank the agencies appearing today for taking the time to testify about these important policy changes, and thank the witnesses especially for being here. As with other policies regulating government use of technology for law enforcement and surveillance purposes, rules to ensure we fully understand what is permitted. I look forward to reviewing policies related to the collection of geolocation and other electronic data to ensure that law enforcement tools are deployed consistently and with respect for privacy and civil liberties. And I yield back.
Thank you, Congressman Liu, and thank you and Ranking Member Kelly. Sure, I yield back.
One more thing before I conclude. I'd like to enter the ACLU letter for the record, if that's okay.
So moved.
Great, thank you.
I'll hold the record open for 5 legislative days for any members who would like to submit a written statement. And now we'll recognize our panel of witnesses. I'm pleased to welcome Ms. Alana Tirungil, Principal Deputy Assistant Attorney General at the Office of Legal Policy at the Department of Justice. Thanks for being here. And again, Mr. Seth Stutter, Assistant Secretary of Threat Prevention and Security Policy at the U.S. Department of Homeland Security. Welcome to you both. And pursuant to committee rules, all witnesses will be sworn in before they testify. So please rise and raise your right hands. Do you solemnly swear or affirm that the testimony you are about to give will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth? Thank you. Please be seated. Let the record reflect that the witnesses answered in the affirmative. In order to allow time for discussion, please limit y'all's testimony for 5 minutes, and your entire written statement will be made part of the record. Ms. Tirungil, we will start with you. You are recognized now for 5 minutes.
Chairman Hurd, Ranking Member Liu, and members of the subcommittee, thank you for inviting me to testify on behalf of the Department of Justice regarding the department's policy guidance on the use of cell site simulator technology. We appreciate the opportunity to engage with the subcommittee on this important topic. Cell site simulators are critical tools that play an essential role in the department's law enforcement and public safety missions. The department has deployed this technology, for example, in efforts to locate and recover kidnapping victims, in operations to apprehend dangerous and violent fugitives, and in complex drug trafficking investigations. The department uses cell site simulators only in the fraction of cases in which the tool is the most effective means of achieving a particular public safety objective. And as with any law enforcement capability, department personnel must use cell site simulators consistent with constitutional and statutory requirements. As you know, in September, the department announced a new policy governing its use of cell site simulators. The policy applies department-wide, establishing common principles for the use of cell site simulators in support of criminal investigations in the United States. It applies when department personnel are working in cooperation with state and local law enforcement, and it makes clear that cell site simulators may not be used to collect the content of any communication. The policy seeks to accomplish four basic objectives. First, to improve training and supervision. Second, to establish a higher and more consistent legal standard. Third, to enhance transparency and accountability. And finally, to increase privacy protections. I'd like to briefly discuss each of these. First, the policy sets forth a number of measures to ensure that law enforcement officers using cell site simulators are trained and supervised appropriately. Each law enforcement agency must establish training protocols, which must include training on privacy and civil liberties. Each agency must also name an executive-level point of contact who will be responsible for ensuring implementation of and compliance with the policy in each jurisdiction. Finally, any use of a cell site simulator must be approved in advance by appropriate personnel. The required level of seniority for the approval depends on the type of use involved. Second, the policy generally requires law enforcement agents to obtain a search warrant supported by probable cause before using a cell site simulator. There are two limited exceptions to the warrant requirement. The first is in exigent circumstances, a well-established exception under Fourth Amendment law, where the needs of law enforcement are so compelling that they render a warrantless search objectively reasonable. Even in these circumstances, agents still must comply with the Pen Register statute. The second limited exception is for cases in which the Fourth Amendment does not require a warrant and circumstances make obtaining a search warrant impracticable. Again, in these circumstances, agents still would need to comply with the Pen Register statute. Third, the policy enhances transparency to courts by requiring law enforcement agents to make clear in their warrant applications that a cell site simulator may be used. Finally, the policy protects individuals' privacy interests by establishing consistent practices for handling the data obtained by these devices. As I have noted, the policy prohibits the use of cell site simulators to obtain the contents of any communication, nor do the devices obtain subscriber information. Even so, the policy establishes deletion requirements for the types of information that they do collect. Auditing programs in each agency will ensure that these requirements are followed. In sum, cell site simulators offer critical support of the department's public safety and law enforcement missions. But as with other capabilities, the department is committed to using the technology in a manner that is consistent with the Constitution and all other legal authorities while respecting individuals' privacy and civil liberties. We hope and believe the policy properly accomplishes these objectives while clearing up any misperceptions. The Department of Justice appreciates the opportunity to discuss our policy with the committee, and I look forward to your questions here today.
Thank you. Mr. Stoddard, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you. Chairman Hurd, Ranking Member Liu, and distinguished members of the subcommittee, thank you for the opportunity to talk with you today about the Department of Homeland Security's policy for how our officers use cell site simulator technology in support of criminal investigations, to protect the American public, and in some cases to locate and rescue victims of human trafficking, child exploitation, and kidnapping. In fact, in one recent case, ICE officers used the technology to rescue a 6-year-old girl who was held hostage by human smugglers in Arizona. And this technology is also used by the Secret Service to protect the president and other dignitaries under the service's protective umbrella. Needless to say, this is an important tool, but it's also a technology that must be used responsibly and consistent with our duty to protect the constitutional rights of the American people. In that spirit, DHS issued a new policy this week on the use of this technology by our officers. I believe the new DHS policy draws the right balance between enabling our officers to use this important tool and protecting the privacy and civil liberties of Americans. Cell site simulators allow DHS officers to identify and generally locate the mobile devices of the subjects and victims of active criminal investigations. They work by collecting signals from cellular devices within the cell site simulator's vicinity, usually within under 1,000 feet, and providing the operator the relative signal strength in the general direction of a subject's cellular device. A cell site simulator, though, is not a GPS locator. It does not provide precise geolocation. And a few other things worth highlighting here as well in terms of what cell site simulators can't do. They don't provide any subscriber account information or any other personal information. And the cell site simulators used by DHS do not collect the content of any communications. No data, no emails, no text messages, no voicemail communications, no content. The new policy issued this week supports the continued use of cell site simulators by our officers, but it also strengthens management controls over the use of this technology. Let me highlight a few provisions that are similar to the DOJ policy. First, the new policy clarifies that before using cell site simulator technology, our officers generally must obtain a warrant from a court founded upon probable cause. There's no Supreme Court authority on this issue, but as a matter of DHS policy, we've concluded that requiring our officers to obtain a warrant founded on probable cause is the appropriate standard here. It draws the right balance between protecting the public and preserving the privacy and civil liberties of Americans. There are two narrow exceptions to this general rule. First, exigent circumstances, as my compatriot here discussed. It's a well-established exception under the Fourth Amendment in emergency cases. And again, as with the DOJ policy, we require in these circumstances a showing of probable cause, but also the use of the pen register statute. Second, under the DHS policy, there's an exception for exceptional circumstances. It's another very specific exception, and in practice, really only applies to the Secret Service's protective mission. The Secret Service's duty is to investigate potential threats to the president or other protected persons, and often this involves very limited information in immediate timeframes. And sometimes the information is cryptic and may not meet the probable cause standard that is required under exigent circumstances. But the threat is imminent, the president's nearby, and the consequences of attack obviously are significant and high. In these circumstances, the Secret Service needs to locate an individual immediately in order to ensure the president's safety. This is a very limited and narrow exception to the general rule, and in these circumstances, DHS policy does not require probable cause or warrant, but does require approval of both an executive within the Secret Service as well as the local U.S. attorney. The policy also requires a court order under the pen register statute or an emergency pen register. The policy also establishes several other key management controls that we believe also draw the right balance between protecting the public and protecting civil liberties and privacy rights. First, the DHS policy requires that applications for search warrants must include an affidavit explaining to the court what a cell site simulator is, how it works, why it will be used in a particular case, and the minor impact it might have on cellular devices in the area. No hiding the ball from the court. Second, the DHS policy draws a strong line on data retention. Bottom line, after a mission is done and the target is identified or located, the operator of the cell site simulator must delete all data from the device. Third, the DHS policy requires components to train and supervise their officers using cell site simulators. In sum, we believe that the need our officers to use cell site simulator technology to keep dangerous criminals off the street and protect the public, and also making sure that we protect the civil liberties and privacy rights of the American people. Chairman Hurd, Ranking Member Liu, and distinguished members of the subcommittee, thank you again for the opportunity to testify today. Look forward to answering any questions you might have.
Thank you for your opening remarks, and now it's a pleasure to recognize my friend and colleague from the great state of North Carolina, Mr. Walker, for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, Ms. Tirangio, Mr. Stoddard, thank you for being here.
Thank you.
I commend both your departments for requiring warrants for the use of these cell site stimulators. Ms. Tirangio, you mentioned that these are now only used on a fraction of cases. Numeric-wise, statistics, do you have any data? When you say fraction of cases, what percentage are we looking at?
So, as I mentioned, these are critical technologies that are deployed in things like kidnappings and complex narcotics investigations and fugitive apprehensions. Those things do occur every day. But the fraction of those cases in which a cell site simulator is deployed is small. I don't have numbers for you today, but I'm happy to get back to you.
If you would get those numbers to us, because a fraction may be broad definitions there. Mr. Stoddard, do you have anything to add to that?
I have a similar response in the sense that, they are a very important tool that's used by both Homeland Security investigations within ICE as well as the Secret Service. And they're used in a very small fraction of cases, but I don't have the numbers with me here, but we can...
Fair enough. Several of you mentioned, both of you mentioned as far as new policy, Mr. Stoddard, and some things that changed September the 1st. Before that timeline, were you allowed to retain or ascertain communication before the new policy was instituted, Ms. Tierengiel?
This policy makes clear that it can, that devices must be configured not to collect content.
Before September 1st, did you collect other content?
I will have to get back to you about what the policies said, but I'll have to take that back.
Okay, Mr. Stoddard?
Well, this is the first DHS policy, overarching DHS policy on the use of cell site simulators, but the components before this policy certainly used cell site simulators but did not use them to collect content at all. I mean, literally the technology is not configured to collect content, at least the technology that DHS...
Well, I'm glad to hear that we have new policies. I do have some trepidation about what we were collecting before then and hope that we can get that information back as well.
Sure.
It leads me to the question, would it be better to enact legislation to make sure these policies are clear? Because my concern is if you have new agency department heads, who makes the standard, who makes the rules there? Ms. Tierengiel, would you like to comment on that?
Sure. Because we have just implemented these policies and because we are about to see how they are implemented and how they work, we would recommend that we evaluate how they are going in practice before anything is codified. On the other hand, anything you wish to work on, we would be happy to work on you with.
Stoddard, would you?
I'd have a similar response in the sense of, I mean, we obviously just issued our policy this week. We feel very good about the policy and strong about the policy. Our operating components definitely believe that the policy draws the right balance between enabling the use of these important technologies and privacy. But certainly, if this committee were to walk down the road of considering legislation, we'd obviously work with the committee on it.
If the warrant requirements for these cell site catchers, if you will, both the DOJ created an exception for circumstances, okay, where the law does not require a search warrant and circumstances make obtaining a search warrant impracticable. Can you talk a little bit about what those impracticable circumstances, I mean, that's kind of broad definition. Would you mind expounding on that, Ms. Tierengiel?
Yeah. This exception is intended to be deployed very rarely, very rare circumstances. And in fact, from the department's perspective, this is more like a safety valve in the policy in the event there are circumstances that we could not foresee when we went to a flat warrant requirement. So in order to use that exception even now, there would need to be no problem under the Fourth Amendment, and it would need to be impracticable to get a warrant, and there would need to be a series of high-level sign-offs in order to use that exception, including a high-level agency official, the U.S. attorney in a jurisdiction, and a deputy assistant attorney general in the criminal division. And any exceptions that are granted under this provision will be tracked by the criminal division so that if there is a set of circumstances that is emerging and the policy needs to be tweaked or adjusted, we can do that.
Sure. So each one of those circumstances, you're telling me that these high level, there's a consistency there that all high levels sign off for no matter what the situation might be.
That's correct. In order to be able to use that exception, all of those people would need to sign off.
I'm concerned about this exception and maybe the augmentation of it or the growth of it were good intentions here, but I'm concerned if we are not able to put some teeth in this that it can be a very broad definition. Mr. Stoddard, I've got about 15 seconds. Did you want to add anything to that?
Well, I mean the analogous exception in the DHS policy is the exceptional circumstances exception, which, as I think I discussed, is the main focus of that exception, at least within DHS, I mean, without putting any conceivable other option, is the Secret Service protective mission in the sense of where it is an exceptional circumstance where probable cause may not necessarily make sense in that context. Okay. So the pen register applies.
My time has expired. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. You'll be right.
Thank you, Mr. Walker. Now I'd like to recognize Ranking Member Liu for 5 minutes.
Thank you. I have a question about the capabilities of these stingrays, not how they can be configured. Just in terms of capability, can they collect content or they cannot?
As I said, our policy requires that they be configured not to collect content. The kind of configuration we're talking about, and understanding that I am a lawyer, not a technologist, is a software configuration, not an on and off switch where someone could switch it on and off.
I'm similarly hampered by being a lawyer, not a technologist, but I will say the DHS, the cell site simulators that DHS agencies use, both HSI as well as Secret Service, are absolutely configured by the vendor not to collect content. I mean, I couldn't tell you one way or the other as to whether they could be theoretically configured to conduct content, but I know for a fact that the cell site simulators that DHS uses do not collect content and cannot collect content.
Okay, if you could get an answer back as to whether they have the capability to,
sure,
not just
we
how
can,
they
we can get back to you on that in terms of whether there are cell site simulators on the market that could, but DHS does not,
okay,
as a matter of policy.
I share some of their same concerns of Mr. Walker regarding the exigent circumstances exception. But I specifically had one about the Secret Service.
Yep.
Is it a blanket exception for the entire Secret Service?
Well, no. It's an exception within the DHS policy and the key exception that we can envision is the Secret Service's protective mission. So it's not an exception for the Secret Service, but in certain circumstances where you could have an immediate threat to the president and you have cryptic information. Our conclusion in terms of drawing the right balance between security and privacy here is to err on the side here of the protection.
But why wouldn't they just fall under exigent circumstances?
Well, because you could have a circumstance because the issue with the exigent circumstances exception is that the exigent circumstances exception still requires probable cause. And so you could have a circumstance with the Secret Service I'm trying to think of a fact situation where it could arise, but where you might have some cryptic email or something like that, or something that indicates there's a threat to the president or to a distinguished person within the Secret Service protective umbrella, where the Secret Service would not have the capability or the time or enough information to determine whether there's probable cause, but you need to locate that person before there's an attack on the president.
I see. So if it's, let's say it's dealing with the Secret Service in a counterfeiting case, that exception would not apply.
No, that would not apply in a Secret Service. In a criminal investigative case, like a counterfeiting case, absolutely not. It would not apply. I mean, that would in a normal, I can't imagine a circumstance where the exceptional circumstances exception would apply in a counterfeiting case.
Now, it looks like there's also an exception for the Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Court. Is that correct in the policy?
The department's policy applies to the use of cell site simulators in furtherance of criminal investigations inside the United States. There is a footnote in the policy that discusses national security investigations that says when working under FISA, the department will make probable cause-based showings and make appropriate disclosures to the court in a manner that is consistent with the policy.
Okay, what does that mean in terms of?
Well, of course, FISA and national security authorities are different than criminal authorities, but the policy does indicate via a footnote that attorneys will make probable cause-based showings to the court, right, and that they will make appropriate disclosures. And of course, there is a whole section in the policy about transparency and the importance of transparency and letting the court know of the technology to be used. But because those authorities are different protocols, different structure and statutes, they are not further defined.
Could the department just apply it the same way with the FISA court? Why would it have to be applied differently?
That is a function of a different court and a different procedural setup based on FISA and that authority particularly. And so it's not the same system or the same authorities, and therefore they're just slightly differently oriented.
Okay. In non-FISA courts, if there is a case that is brought, the ACLU letter references information where prosecutors will not disclose a Stingray was used. In fact, they'll say it was a confidential source. Do you have any thoughts on that, or can your policy say that ought to be disclosed rather than using the quote-unquote confidential source phrase?
I'm not familiar with the ACLU letter. I can tell you that the policy has a detailed section on transparency that prosecutor must let the court know about the technology to be used, how it will be used, the disruption it might cause, to ensure that should the court have questions or that the court knows in advance about this technology.
So I've entered the ACLU letter in the record. I also sent it to you. If you don't mind, if you could respond to the issues they raised, that'd be terrific. And then let me, if I could take one more question. In terms of how you think this is going to be applied, how are you training your folks on this?
Implementation is ongoing, and the components are actively working on ensuring that all the pieces of this are falling into place.
And what about local and state law enforcement? Do you do any guidance, any training?
I can tell you that anecdotally, a couple of state and local agencies have asked about this policy. We're hopeful that it will serve as a model. Beyond that, at this time, that's all the information that I have.
Okay, thank you. I yield back.
Thank you. I recognize myself for 5 minutes. Let's pick up on Congressman Liu's line. So when local law enforcement, they can attain these devices without DOJ's permission, is that correct?
They can buy and operate this equipment on their own, yes.
Is DOJ planning to require state and local law enforcement agencies to adhere to DOJ's policy or have similar policies of their own?
So this policy, the department's policy, will apply to state and locals when we are working together and when we are assisting state and locals. It is complicated and difficult beyond that for us to oversee the state and locals, but as I said, we are really hopeful that this will serve as a model for state and locals as they think about their own policies.
Does DOJ provide any of these stingrays to local law enforcement?
Not that I'm aware of, but I would want to double check and get back to you.
Yeah, my question there is if DOJ is providing the equipment to local law enforcement, then can they be bound by the rules of DOJ and the operation of this? That would be my question.
I'd be happy to take it back.
Great. And Mr. Stoddard, can people apply for this within DHS?
Well, you're asking for in terms of the state and locals. Similarly, the DHS policy says that if DHS officers are working on a case with state and local governments, certainly the DHS policy applies in that circumstance to the DHS officers and in that task force sort of environment. DHS does not actually give or loan this equipment to state and local law enforcement. DHS does not do that. Certainly, and the state and local governments can purchase this equipment on their own using their state funds and consistent with their own state laws and the federal constitution under their own police powers under the constitution. The issue here I think you're getting at perhaps is certainly state and local governments can apply for federal grant funds from FEMA, and the federal government under FEMA and I believe the Justice Department as well, we give grant monies to the states, and then the states and then sub-grantees, the local governments, can purchase equipment that is on an authorized equipment list. And certainly some states could conceivably purchase cell site simulator technology. And our position on that essentially is, our standard terms and conditions and grant funding to the states and local governments is essentially to, they have to apply, they have to use the technologies that they buy with consistent with the law and consistent with the Constitution. But we haven't imposed essentially our internal DHS policies in this context or other contexts on the state and local governments with regard to the grant dollars, with regard to the equipment that they buy using federal grant dollars.
So just so I'm clear, I'm a local law enforcement, let's say I'm a county sheriff.
Yep.
I apply for Stone Garden funds, I get them, I buy an IMSI catcher, and I would not be bound by DHS policy on the use of said IMSI catchers.
You would not, correct. You would not be bound by DHS policy with regard to the use of cell site simulators yourself. That's correct.
So is there any effort on the way to have folks using federal funds, using DHS funds or DOJ funds to adhere to the rules and regulations? Because aren't there some significant non-disclosure agreements that are signed by local law enforcement Is it with y'all or with the companies when it comes to this issue?
Not with the Department of Homeland Security. We do not require those kinds of non-disclosure agreements when the state and local governments say were to use something like that. I think, and the question of whether the Department of Homeland Security would essentially require essentially state and local governments using federal funds to, you know, the city of Bakersfield or whoever else to apply internal DHS policies. We've not sort of determined that would be the right approach for a number of reasons, from federalism, but also from the perspective of you're talking about a $1.5 billion grant program of 56 grantees and thousands of sub-grantees, and the ability to track the use of all these sub-grantees, of all this equipment. I mean, I think that would be a significant consideration to think about.
Thank you. Yes, ma'am.
I'm sorry.
Yeah, the same question. I believe some of local law enforcement enter into NDAs with the FBI on some of the use of this technology. Is that correct? And how does that work?
Yeah, so the non-disclosure agreements that you're referring to are agreements between the FBI and state and local law enforcement. Those agreements are intended to protect particularly sensitive information about the operation of the technology, the capabilities of the technology. They're not meant, actually, to preclude more transparency in terms of disclosing that they've been used in any particular case, and actually FBI is revising those agreements now. But as to the question about how they intersect with state and local use, traditionally they're not a means to oversee the actual use of the equipment. Rather, they're an agreement about the sensitivity of the information involved.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to now recognize Mr. Liu for an additional 5 minutes.
Thank you. Let me follow up on Chairman Hurd's questions about the FBI. So I have a letter from April 13, 2015, written from the Federal Communications Commission to Senator Bill Nelson. My understanding, according to this letter, is that for these devices to be used by law enforcement, they have to be certified by the FCC. And the commission places two conditions on them. One is that these devices will be used, in fact, by law enforcement. And second, that state and local law enforcement agencies must coordinate in advance with the FBI the acquisition and use of the equipment. Is there any reason we couldn't, consistent with the DOJ policy, ask the FBI to say, okay, if you're going to use this equipment, you need to use it consistent with our FBI standards, which are DOJ standards, which is you need to get a warrant before you use it.
So as I was mentioning, these agreements that you referenced to are with respect to the sensitivity of the information and agreements about how to manage that sensitivity. They may be more or less effective at managing and affecting oversight over the use of this technology, but it is something we're happy to look at.
Thank you. And then Mr. Stouter, I forgot to ask you the first time.
Yeah.
We'll send you the ACLU letter as well.
Thank
you. If you could respond to some of the issues that they raised, that'd be great as well.
We're happy to do that.
So I have a different line of question, which is these policies don't apply to the NSA or CIA or other agencies other than your own, correct?
Correct.
What happens if the FBI is doing an operation with local law enforcement? Can they sort of say, hey, you local law enforcement, you go use the Stingray and do what we can't do? Is there anything in policy that keeps them from doing that?
If I'm understanding your question correctly, if the FBI is working with the locals and using a cell site simulator, this...
Well, the FBI is not using it, but the local person is using it.
Oh, as in the FBI would get around this policy, that is not permitted.
Okay, thank you. In terms of these other agencies, what law enforcement other than, let's take out the intelligence agencies, but what other law enforcement would not be covered by the two policies here today?
Well, it would be law enforcement that's not part of the Department of Homeland Security or the Department of Justice, so presumably the Park Police or, I'm informed, the government printing office potentially has a...
Correct.
Yeah. So are there other law enforcement agencies that would not be covered?
I'm not aware of which other law enforcement agencies would even have this capability.
Yeah.
So.
And then you had mentioned earlier, there's going to be tracking of the number of times that these devices are used, or only when they're used without a warrant?
No, the policy requires a tracking of numbers annually of how many times they're used and how many times they're used in emergency circumstances, in addition to the requirement under the exceptional circumstances exception to track any and all exceptions under that provision of the policy.
And that's both agencies?
Correct.
And who gets this information?
The agencies are required to track and collect their use, and the criminal division tracks the number of exceptions granted.
Would this committee get that information, or could this committee get that information? Is it public?
We'd be happy to work with you on any requests you have for that information.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Similarly true of the DHS.
Thank you. I yield back.
I'd like to recognize the gentleman from Iowa, Mr. Bloom, for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Chairman Hurd, and thank you, Ms. Tyringel, is it?
Tyringel.
Tyringel, and Mr. Stoddard for appearing today. Appreciate it very much. I've got about 5 questions to each one of you, so you can be quasi-brief. We can get through this in 5 minutes. First question, does your agency take the position that it does not need a warrant?
Our agency has gone to a policy that requires a warrant with two narrow circumstances for exceptions. So we are now using a warrant as a general matter, except in 2 circumstances.
And those are?
Exigent briefly. Circumstances that would satisfy the Fourth Amendment's warrant exception, and exceptional circumstances where the Fourth Amendment is not implicated and getting a warrant is impracticable. So even if the Fourth Amendment isn't implicated, if it's not impracticable to get a warrant, agents must get a warrant. And if there are exceptional circumstances that we expect to occur very rarely, then there would need to be sign-off from a high-level agency official, the U.S. attorney, and a deputy assistant attorney general from the criminal division. And even in such circumstances—
To not get a warrant.
Exactly.
What were those 3 individuals? A high-level?
A high-level agency official within the law enforcement agency, the U.S. attorney in the district, and the deputy assistant attorney general in the criminal division.
Is it all 3 or any of those 3?
All 3.
All 3. To not get a warrant.
That's right.
Okay. Mr. Stoddard?
As a matter of DHS policy, similarly to DOJ policy, DHS policy, we have determined that that before the use of cell site simulators, that we will require probable cause and a warrant in most cases, with 2 exceptions, similar exceptions to the Justice Department. One is exigent circumstances, so involving, you know, well-recognized Fourth Amendment exception if there's life and limb at issue, and et cetera. And the second is exceptional circumstances, which in the DHS context is, the main example here would be the Secret Service protective mission with regard to the protection of the president, which is not a criminal, but it's where probable cause may not necessarily be the right standard in that context. So, and again, we also have, you know, significant sign-off where the Secret Service believes that it needs to have a cell site simulator but does not have probable cause or won't get a warrant, but we would need sign-off from a senior-level executive within the Secret Service as well as the local U.S. attorney. And even there, we would also apply the Penn Register statute, essentially, to obtain a court order to use the technology or an emergency Penn Register under the Penn Register statute.
So both of those signatures required, or just one of the 2?
Both.
Both. Well, what about when the suspect is the subject of an arrest warrant? Is there any change there?
No, a search warrant is still required under the policy. Again, barring exigent circumstances that would satisfy the Fourth Amendment's warrant exception or the exceptional circumstances provision that I described to you that requires all that sign-off and fitting in with particular circumstances.
Same with the address.
Tell me if this is correct or not. I believe I have it correct. Each agency's policy requires deletion of the data at least once every 30 days?
So our policy—
Is that correct?
Yes, and it also requires deletion as soon as the mission is completed. So if it's before 30 days in the circumstance where you're trying to identify an unknown phone, it gets deleted immediately. It doesn't wait until the 30 days.
And the same is true under the DHS policy. It requires deletion immediately after the mission.
Right after the mission.
Yeah.
Now, government's great at making laws, setting rules and regulations. I think I'm from the private sector. Where we're weak is follow through. So my question is, what mechanism is there in place to ensure that what you just said actually happens?
So there are a couple provisions in the policy that address this. One is there needs to be an auditing procedure put in place by each agency to make sure that the data is deleted consistent with the policy. And second, the policy requires each agency to designate an executive level point of contact in each jurisdiction to ensure that the policy is implemented and complied with.
Mr. Stoddard?
The DHS policy is identical in that respect.
So is this currently in place, or is this?
Yes.
The policy is effective immediately.
And in place.
And what would the, out of curiosity, what would the punishment be if this policy is not followed? Because I've sat in on enough of these hearings and had people sit in your chairs where things, you know, weren't followed through on, things were messed up, they were against the rules, IG says they need to change and they don't change, and they receive bonuses instead of being terminated. So what happens if the rules are not followed?
As with any technology procedure within an agency, if individuals violate their agency's orders, they're accountable to their agencies and subject to discipline.
And the same thing is true in DHS. I mean, each component will have a structure essentially to hold their employees accountable for not using technologies in a way that's authorized by DHS policy, and certainly DHS headquarters would have a similar sort of capability of management response.
So you're saying it's the department's policy?
Yes.
Yeah, I hope you will tell us today at this hearing that if someone doesn't follow these policies and somebody's privacy rights are in question, that you're going to take the appropriate actions.
Yes.
Go ahead.
Department of Homeland Security and certainly the component leaderships would take whatever appropriate action would make sense under the facts and circumstances of that case.
Same here.
Great. I think my time is up. I yield back, Mr. Chairman. Thank you very much.
I have a very basic question, but before we end, is the private use of MZ catchers, is that illegal?
I don't know the details of sort of how the manufacturers market themselves or to whom they can provide this, or whether it is illegal. I can speak, obviously to the government use and to these agreements between the state and locals and the FBIs, but not the private use.
Yeah, I'm similarly hampered by lack of knowledge on that in this sense, but we are happy to get back to you on that.
Great, thank you. I apologize we started late today, but this is an important issue of being able to protect our civil liberties and ensure that law enforcement has the tools they need in order to do their jobs. I think the plans have come a long way over these past few months, and we look forward to the additional information that we requested and having further conversations on this and looking forward on how we can have some legislative fixes to this across federal government. I appreciate y'all's time here today, I thank you for taking your time to appear, and if there's no further business, without objection, the subcommittee stands adjourned.
Thanks for having me.